So hi everybody, my name is Fieke and I work for Tactical Tech. And before I get started, like you said, this would be a more practical angle because we work around everything from information for activism. And what we do is that we give digital security and data and privacy trainings, and we sort of do explorations into what happens to your data and how can you be profiled. So I'll be talking about this today. And the talk today is about art, education, and cooperation, why the digital matters. And this comes from because Julian asked me, he said, we had just had this case in Russia, for instance, is cooperation, or we have artists who collaborate with people in China and they don't think about the social or political context in which these other artists are operating. And so that's one thing, because the internet and mobiles all around communication. And with communication, a lot of data gets created and a lot of profiles get created. So we'll go into that. But the other thing can also be if your artwork is hyper-political, you might also be on a watch list, is what we call it. So this is why Julian asked me to give a talk. And what we'll first be looking at is what can actually be told by data. And for this, we'll look at email and mobile phones to sort of get a bearing of what is this digital landscape that we're navigating before we go into practical, what can you actually do to mitigate it. And I want to start by looking at email metadata. So there's this amazing group called Share Foundation, and they do a lot of data investigations. And what they did was there was a hack of a tech company that works for secret services. So of course this already becomes super exciting. And their email got hacked because this is a company that sells viruses to governments to be able to hack activists, but also artists who are in political engagement all across the world. And the funny thing is their email server got hacked because they had the password 1234. This is some of the most highly sophisticated hackers, and their password is 1234. So of course this was a joke in the entire sort of scene I belong to. And what this Share Foundation did is they took this dump of this entire email database and they said, if we just look at the metadata of this company, which is called Hacking Team, what can we actually tell about this company? And because everybody, well, most people probably have Gmail or Yahoo, they can actually see exactly the same things as the Share Foundation saw in this data investigation into Hacking Team. And so they looked at the metadata, because most of the time when we're communicating, we think that the most valuable data is actually in the content. So maybe it's the things we are writing. And for instance, Gmail does keyword analysis. So they look at if you use certain words, maybe moving, I want shopping, and then they give you advertising. But actually the metadata of your email is way more important because it's very structured. And computers can analyze it. So they don't need people to look at it, they just have computers to analyze it. And so the metadata of your email is you, your email address, the people you're sending it to, their email address, time, which is really important, subject line, and in certain cases, your IP address. So this can be your location. So what they were able to tell when they analyzed the entire bulk of metadata of this hacking company is they could make an organizational graph. They could see who the boss was because he sent the most amount of emails for the longest period of time. So they sort of made a social graph of who is emailing to who, in what frequency, and what is in the subject line. And they were able to replicate what actually the organizational structure is. So every email you send looks very innocent, but in the end, if you collect it in bulk, you can actually tell a lot about, for instance, a company or a collective or a network. And then they looked at this Mr. D. So they thought, okay, this guy sends the most emails, he must be the boss. Let's take a look at what he does. So they isolated only his emails, and then they started looking. And so they looked at time. They tried to establish a pattern on time. How often does he send an email when? So what you see here is actually he is an early riser because the most emails he sends is in 4 a.m. in the morning. And then at 7, he probably has breakfast. He sends few emails. And then you can sort of see how it goes over the day. And at the end, he goes to bed early. And why is time important? Because with time, you can actually establish patterns. When does something do what? And the thing is, like, people are creatures of behavior. So when I cycle, for instance, from my home to my work, I always take the same route. So probably this guy always gets up at 4 o'clock in the morning to start sending emails. So this is his pattern. And this is what you can tell from data. And then this is the same sort of amount of emails, but it visualized in a different way. And here you can see sort of the rows is one day. And the darker square becomes, the more emails he sends. And sort of on the second row, a little bit at the bottom, you see this flurry of dark patches around. So they started looking at what was so special on this day. And it was actually when a Canadian university, so this company has been operating in an obscure zone. Nobody knew they existed. And then in June, a Canadian university found out who they were, and they published the newspaper. And then all these emails were sending, they were sent it, oh my God, they found out who we were, help. All the sort of subject lines are really funny, like, what is this, Citizen Lab, which is the Canadian university. So you can tell that something's up. In the third column, you can also see that there becomes, he breaks his pattern. And so they thought, oh, okay, this is interesting. He doesn't send his emails in the morning. He goes offline for a long time. What does he do? And then they went to look in the subject line of these emails, and they saw that he bought a ticket to Hong Kong. So he was flying, actually, so he was offline, so they couldn't find him. And this is actually what you can tell in patterns of metadata when people are, when there's an anomaly in your behavior. And why I'm showing this example is because we think of all our interactions with our devices or our communication as a one-off, but it's actually the bulk that really tells something about us. And this is also how Secret Service is looking at your data, for instance. And then the second thing I want to look at is phones, because if you communicate with other artists, most people do it over their phone. And these are just a bunch of data traces. Your phone creates more. They're the most insecure device you will have. But it's your name. Probably if I scan the Wi-Fi network now, I can see a lot of names popping up, like John's iPhone or Fika's iPhone or an Android. So you can usually tell the name from a device. The time. So the time is quite important, like we saw in the email example, because you can see what time, for instance, you send a text. So you probably won't send a text to your boss at 2 a.m. on Friday night. So these must be your friends. So you can already correlate social patterns from it. Your phone number, because in most cases, that's actually tied to your legal identity in most countries. Then you have text messages and calls. And from this, you can really establish social patterns, like and your location data. And this frequency is also interesting, because if you put together, for instance, time, your location, and frequency, I can already predict from your phone where you live. Because your phone will rest most of the night in your house, and during the day it will move somewhere else. And this is really accurate. This is like to a couple of meters accurate. So the frequency of how often you call somebody or how often you are somewhere is really important, and the time. So this is a nice image how actually the location gets collected, because your device, sort of your phone, gives location data away in several ways. So one is your GPS. It communicates with a satellite. This is how your navigation system works. But one thing is the reason why you can walk and talk with your mobile phone is because it triangulates where you are. So your phone is always looking where the closest cell phone towers are. And this is just to make the infrastructure work. This is the same for metadata. Without it, you cannot send an email. So your phone is inherently a tracking device. So when you are going into maybe something political, do a political action, you could also leave your phone at home, because they will know where you are. The people who would have access to the network will know where you are. And then in Germany and Switzerland, there was an interesting project of two Green Party politicians who asked all their cell phone data from their mobile phone provider. So this is sort of what a bulk of data looks like. And they analyzed it sort of on location data, so you could actually move them, follow them around. You can tell where they lived, you could tell where they worked, you could actually tell when they were traveling. But they also started correlating who they were texting, who they were calling, who they were chatting on Facebook, because this is all in the data package you get from your telco provider. And so with a little bit of data, you can probably establish some patterns. So you can say, oh, maybe these people talk to each other. With more data, it already becomes sort of more clearer. These are probably your friends. These are maybe your work colleagues. But if you have, for instance, if you're a telco provider, you have data of millions of subscribers. So then you can really start making really clear social graphs, because it's not just your cell phone. It's also the cell phone of your friends, of your family, of your neighbors, of everybody basically in a country. So the thing with data is it's getting collected even while we're sitting here and maybe not using it because your phone is in your bag. And it might sound a little bit depressing, but I think it's important to understand how the infrastructure works and also how this data is being created and collected so that you actually know what you can do. Because it's not that we have to sit back and just die. I think we do have some ownership over our data, and we should claim it back, especially when we're working with people in different political and social contexts, like Russia, China, Iran, maybe even France. I mean, it depends on the topics you work on. And I think the first thing is, the first step is to ask yourself, if you are engaged in a collective or if you start a new project, is what is it that I'm actually doing? Is this politically sensitive? And maybe it might not be politically sensitive in Germany, but it might be politically sensitive somewhere else. And who am I communicating with, or who am I working with? Because your actions also impact other people. And then you can make a choice, like choose it. Choose the platform and service you're using, and I'll show another graph later how to do it. Change it. You can change a lot. You can choose different tools. You can change the settings. All these things that are called privacy settings are by default set in a way that you don't have any privacy. So change them to get privacy. Choose to access it in a different way or hide it and play with it. Because the thing is, there's no such thing as 100% security or privacy. You saw that as I gave them a hacking team example. These are some of the smartest hackers in the world, and they have a password 1234. So I mean, there is no 100% security or privacy, and it is about sort of playing around with it and getting started. So how do you choose a service? And because Julian gave the example of this Russian cooperation, I thought, okay, it is mostly about communication as well and about public profiling, but if you communicate, let's say I chose here Messenger's apps, there are ways to think about whether you can, what is better to use. So I did WhatsApp, Viber. I don't know if anybody's using Viber, but it's Signal, WeChat, and just a regular text message, because we probably use all of them. And so the first question we at Tactical Tech ask ourselves is it open source? So there's a difference between open source and commercial. And commercial basically means that it's a company owned. External people cannot look in the code to see if it's properly implemented. And it has a base. It has like usually one legal jurisdiction that it's tied to. If it's open source, other people can look at the code. I mean, I cannot understand the code, but I can still trust that in the open source community, people have looked at it. And it's not tied to one jurisdiction, which is also a great thing. So as you see, WhatsApp's not open source, Viber's not open source, WeChat's not open source, and text message's not open source, and these because they're all commercial products. The only one is Signal. I put in the Signal one as an outlier. And then we also think about, is it encrypted? And that's really important to distinguish that encryption only goes on the content, and it never goes around the metadata. So it only goes around the messages you write, and not about social graphing and other types of like location tracking, for instance. So there's only two that are encrypted. Here you can actually hide the message of your communication. It's WhatsApp and Signal. And then with choosing tools, it's always like, what do you know about this company? It might be a little bit difficult. But we all have a natural sense of geopolitics. And so then it becomes important, like, who the organization, who is the company, and where is it located? So for instance, WhatsApp, owned by Facebook. Maybe you might have an issue with that, or maybe not. The jurisdiction is in the USA, which means that all of your data falls under the Patriot Act. You might be OK with that, too. What becomes interesting is as well is that, for instance, in Asia, WeChat is a super popular chat program. It's not encrypted and it's owned by the Chinese. And when you ask people this question, they immediately swap to something else and they install a different program because for them it's super politically sensitive. And then another thing to ask is also, when you install any application on your phone, but especially with Messenger applications, what actually do they have access to? Do they want? There was this thing about a flashlight that wanted access to your location data. There's no reason why a flashlight should have access to your location data. And here you can also think about, can I create an anonymous account? Does it have access to my phone number? What is all the data I share with it? So this is sort of questions you can ask yourself when choosing an application to communicate to people in another part of the world. And then I also want to go to play it. And for me, this is digital security and privacy always sounds super serious. And you have to open your computer. And it's are always tools that are maybe not so usable. But the thing is that a lot of security and privacy also comes from actions you can do offline. You can leave your phone at home, for instance. Maybe you can actually meet somebody face to face instead of like creating, sending an email. And we have created four sort of strategies. The first is reduction. Just delete those old apps that you're no longer using because they continue getting information. Maybe you want to choose alternatives to commercial services because you might trust the organization better, or you might not want Google or Facebook to know more about you. Obfuscation is a fun one. How can you create so much noise that they cannot find you anymore? So you have add-ons that you can put in the browser, for instance, that every time you make a search, they send 10 false search requests so that the computer doesn't know what is a serious search or what isn't a serious search. Offline, it could be people wearing the same clothes. You can obfuscate your identity in many different ways. And I think maybe the simplest one is also when you talk about something politically sensitive, you don't actually have to use the words. I was talking to some Chinese activists, and they actually always talked about, like, cornflakes. And that actually was a code word for something else. So there's a lot of like obfuscation techniques people have used in the real world, but that we don't use in the digital world because somehow it's magical. Compartmentalize, it means just separate. Maybe you do want to use WhatsApp to talk to your friends and family, but maybe when you talk to somebody in Russia, you might want to use Signal, for instance. It doesn't have to be a zero-sum game, but you can actually separate your identities in this. And fortification is if you're working on something really sensitive and you go across a border, or if you go somewhere, you can also not have it on your computer, but on a separate USB that is encrypted. So it's also about playing with different ways in which you can control your data. And I think I'm almost at the end. So here are some websites where you can find more. Security in a Box actually gives you step-by-step introductions on how you can install certain tools. And My Shadow looks more at sort of the privacy angle of things. And I think I have still some minutes if people have questions. Yes, looking in the thing. If you have questions, you can raise your hand. Yeah?
So maybe in the break, you have the opportunity to talk to Fike in private where nobody can listen. And no, but in all seriousness, your work is groundbreaking and it helps a lot of people. And I'm glad you're here today.
Thanks.
Thank you very much and best to your colleagues.